Good evening. New microphone today, so hopefully I sound a lot better than I have in previous streams. So I suppose people have to let me know whether they like the new microphone or not. We'll see how it goes. So, just gonna check my picture real quick. Yep, we're good. Cool. So, last time we were playing around with input stuff. And we got graphics on screen, that's very important. We did this nice thing here. We actually have two copies of this, which I'm probably gonna change. Because it's a bit much. We'll see how it goes. So, if we do it like this, we only move the one frame at a time. Let's close that. Let's try a different version of this though. How do I check the difference? Well, let's see what this is doing. So, saying, here's the previous buttons. Okay, it's in the starter kit that they've got there. All right. Oh well. So let's see. Let's see how we do it. Maybe just recording the previous buttons is enough. Okay. So, this is probably on the wrong side. I'm not sure how that's going to come through on the microphone now I think about it, but there we are. Some buttons. And then we'll have a button repeat timer. I assume the DB initializes to zero, right? That's probably true. All right. It's probably fine. So. Oh, right, those are H's because they'll be held in high RAM. That makes sense. I'm not quite sure how I want to use the high RAM yet, which is why I'm not doing it, so. Now, I don't fully remember where the high RAM is. Let's go check. Yeah, so you get a very small number of bytes. What's 8x16? I should really know that. 128 bytes that are faster than the rest of the RAM. Some of that is taken up by my DMA stuff, so that's not all available, but the rest of it you can use for faster things. But we're probably working in this bit of RAM for the most part. I know that we've taken up the first chunk of this with our shadow OAM, so we're only using the latter half. Well, not even half, it's actually a lot less than that, it's only 9F bits of data, 40 by 8, whatever that is. So, I'm not doing that though here yet, anyway. I'm sure we'll get there, because I'm going to burn through cycles real quick. It's just figuring out how to conceptually figure this out. So, th- this bit here would be writing this stuff. So, this is like, there are no keys held, so you just jump straight over it, or oh, I see, you, okay, I see what they're doing, so you keep track of the previous set of keys. Oh, we can get rid of this pressed keys thing then. Well, we can change how this all works, probably. Before I do too much of that, though, I should probably just store the state of things. Naming stuff for input. Get input. We don't even need to do it like that because we actually already have that. As just buttons, I guess. So we could do something like, sorry, my brain is sort of ticking through how we meant to do this. It's all very granular. Let's take this bit all out for the moment. So that's just our button array. Like that. I guess we'll put this back for the moment, but yeah. So LDA buttons LD like that. Buttons and help buttons, okay. Load B from A. load A with held buttons and B. So this gets us the things that changed. If nothing changed here, or like if the count is new, then we'll just nope out of there. Otherwise, I suppose you might want to do this a bit differently. That's what I get for trying to ask for help early. Because what I'd like to do is basically, it's like you press a key, you hold it, it does something, waits a second, does it again, does it again, does it again. Sort of like holding a button in Tetris. But not sure. I guess you could kind of cheat it by basically just counting how many frames is the input, not zero. Which might be a good stepping stone to where we want to go here, so I might just do that first. And A. If it's not zero, then like that, so. Otherwise, load A with zero, and then load button repeat timer. A sets it to zero. And jump to the nope. Otherwise, load A with the BTN repeat timer, ink A, and then write it back. I guess that'll be a bit strange if you changed your inputs midway through, because it wouldn't pick that up, which kind of sucks. So maybe this is worse, I'm not sure. My brain. You probably have to do this per button mask, right? That's probably what they're going for. But we'll figure it out. So, okay, so you would do it like that instead. Okay. Let's do a different thing here. So, come on, we can do this. Counter is at zero, we increase the counter. Well, add a let's say every fifth. It's like skipping over, so yeah. Hi Ruby, how's my audio? That's good. Better than usual or worse than usual? That's good. One would hope that a new microphone would be better. So we're trying out a new setup. My brain is totally not functioning on this thing, though. I might just give up on it and come back later, though, on that. So, come on. We can do this. Because basically what ends up happening is that you would Check if it's zero, do that bit, do that bit. Okay. Jump and see skip input. Load A buttons. This might well. See what happens. Nothing happens. That's what happens. So the question is why? Let's see if we can find out why. It wouldn't be a Game Boy development stream if I didn't have to do at least one bit of debugger stuff. Breakpoint. Cool. Okay, next up would be 023F. No, did I just? Missed my chance. Okay. Breakpoint 186. So then the next one would be 28B. And then I want to go over this to 184. And then if and then 1/AB or BB, I suppose. Kind of wish I could overlay my labels into the debugger so I didn't have to do this every time. Maybe there's a way of doing that, that'd be quite handy. Okay. Okay, so we're here now. I think that this call is actually my input code. So it goes and it builds all the stuff for our input. This time there is no input, so I guess that it just jumps straight over everything. I don't know if there's a way of simulating input in this debugger. Well, I guess what we could do instead is something else. So I guess we need to do an OR. B. Oh, it works. Look at that. I'm holding down the key and it is gradually moving. Okay. So if I make that bigger now, if I did this will probably move at half speed. Or maybe not. That's a shame. Maybe we fluked out then. What was it? That was on 8. Oh, I guess we fluked, because that's not working anymore. Oh. Well then. That's a puzzle. Right. If a key is held down, well, if a key is currently pressed, then it won't be zero, or it shouldn't be zero. So we go to here. And then we add all this stuff. Otherwise, we reset the timer to zero. I guess that would mean that you've always got a slight delay. No, this doesn't work. Ugh. That's really annoying. Let's take that back out. So this should be back to smooth movement. Yeah. Okay. Node A with the held buttons, so that's our previous ones, and then we do XOR B. Don't want to lose power. That'll be quite embarrassing. Press buttons A, like that. So then call. Okay, so we actually figure out a lot of that stuff already. Right, so that's just checking if we went down. Git diff. Yeah, so that's collecting all those inputs now. So then we do load a hold buttons. Well, no, we actually should set this up slightly differently. Pad F down. We'll do that. Basically, I'm making like a bitmaster the keys that we actually care about. And we'll put that in B. So this just gets us the held keys that we care about. That. So then we can nope out of there if buttons aren't held. Load A with the pressed buttons. So now if we're pressing any of the special buttons that we care about, like that. Button was just pressed. Loads. Like that. Load A with the button repeat timer so that we can decrement it. Now if it's not zero, then we're not repeating it yet. Interval, no repeat, LD button repeat timer. Okay. And I guess that this bit all should kind of be maybe a macro? I don't know if we can do a macro like that. Although I guess we could kind of skip over everything. Like that. No. Can't do that. There we go. Doesn't look like it. That's so strange. That's pretty weird. But that's kind of what I get for hacking at this thing. That doesn't seem to help at all, so. Just double checking I didn't screw up something obvious. Oh, that's. That should be fine. It should write 1 and then subtract 1. That seems okay. Oh, I know the problem. You need to do that. Actually, that's not true, but it's the buttons. Is that it? Not quite. Oh, kind of. It just doesn't want to do it for the left. Probably because I need to do it here. I see. Yeah. No, that's fine. Because then, nope, not down. Right. I understand now. Well, I thought I did. Why is that not? Yeah, we go. There we go. That's got it. So the issue there was just that I wasn't actually restoring the value for the buttons after doing all of this repetition shenanigans. But that's pretty good. Ugh, cry out loud. What is that emoji? Or react? Is it an emoji in Twitch? I don't know. It's like Pikachu doing maths. Okay, I see, I see. It's all good. Yeah, that is kind of how I feel. Assembly stuff does fry your brain a little bit. Oh. Can I get away without doing the pressed array for things? If I just use buttons here, does that still work? Hold on. No, I do have to use that still. Okay. I was hoping I could get away without having to do some extra calculations, but no, I can't. I basically have to detect when. Oh, yeah, no, that makes sense because I would be assuming that the button had just been pressed every single frame, which is not the case. But now we have this sort of movement thing going on, so I can do other stuff. Like that, and do guess what? Oh, no! There! Okay. I'm aiming to get this like grid-based movement thing going on, but that is not working. So, why does that not work at larger? Oh, well, now it's working. It kind of takes a moment, which is strange. But that's what I wanted. Oh, it's also not instant. It sort of has to synchronize, which is probably not right. Okay. But that should overwrite it, so it should make it a 1, which makes it a 0, then it is 0, so it just does the bit that it's supposed to do. That's what I would expect anyway. What the heck is going on with my phone? Come back to that. Yeah, so like it doesn't always. Suppose it doesn't always register it as being held, maybe? That could be it. But then. The previous frame buttons becomes this frames. Oh, it's because they're not actually held, are they? It's just the previous frames stuff, so. How do you know if it's actually been held? I guess that you would do this horrible bit of shuffling, and you would get the held result, and then you have to do. This bit to figure out if it's oh, but if you do that, you corrupt the results in the other way. Ugh. You kind of end up doing too much stuff, so there has to be a better way. He's currently down is this one. We put it in the B register so that we just have access to it. So that bit's going to be fine. We fetch the held buttons. This is currently buttons from previous frame. So if you AND the two, you get the stuff that's held. That's fine. But I have to restore that. Again here with buttons to check the pressed buttons behavior. That's so weird. It's like, could it just be uninitialized memory for the timer? I don't know if I have to specify what the thing is. Not that it necessarily matters, but yeah, so I'm holding the key down and it takes ages to actually do anything. And then it just kind of works. But it still doesn't. Respond immediately to input. I can't tell if that's the emulator or my code, but probably my code that's the issue. That's kind of doing it. Might be good to use a controller for this in the future. I don't really trust my Mac keyboard either. Okay. Can I just do pause? Because if that works, that's pretty cool. Don't think I can do this across lines, but I'll give it a go anyway. Yeah, I don't think so. Oh, but maybe it, ooh, it didn't work actually. It broke things. Maybe it needs to be a. Maybe I probably just used the wrong operator. Let's do that. That's better. Yeah, there's definitely a delay between the screen being drawn and everything else. Which is strange. Maybe our debouncing is wrong. Or just not enough, maybe, but it was working fine for previous things, so I wouldn't expect that to be the case. I don't think that this matters. To be honest, none of this should be done. Until we're sort of ready to start here. That seemed a little bit snappier. Let's try it again. I wish I could kind of monitor the input while stuff was happening, because it's definitely not doing anything straight away. Get status. Key repeat code works. No, I didn't actually have to do that. Okay, so this should be the repeating version. Yeah. No, that is instantaneous. Okay, there's something definitely strange happening with us. Oh, I know though. So, okay. Maybe the problem is that I'm actually not initializing the button and held button states for things. That's a reasonable. So if we do that now. There we go, that was it. Okay. So RAM wasn't initialized correctly on those three flag sets. And so it took a while to settle and resolve. Ah. Only took an hour and 20 minutes. How did anyone do this for a job? Okay. Yeah, practice and experience. It's true. I suppose you'd have some... Well, I don't know, actually. Would you have had library code in the early 90s for this sort of thing? I don't know what computers were used to develop Game Boy games. That sort of era. I know that with the NES you'd have used like an Apple II or something, but... Game Boy is a lot newer than that, surprisingly enough, so... Don't know. Anyway, that gets us very nice grid-based movement. So what's next? I suppose putting other objects into the world might be good. Making a collision with tile maps might be better. Although for that, I would need to store the map on screen. Well, store the map and then draw based on it. Which is not a terrible idea. Although if... Maybe you can just get away with reading... Can you read the VRAM? That's a good question. Just trying to figure out the best way to go about this. I assume that you could just do collision detection by reading the tile map directly for a given space. So yeah, what you'd want to do is be like, check destination. It's like that. Function returns. Well, I suppose actually you'd, yeah. In HL of the tunnel map. Well, that's not quite what I want to do. In the tile map, H is the Y, L is the X. So what you would do, I think, would be to let's have a look. Coordinates are taken as world, as screen position. Very important. Push HL, just so that we keep it, and then pop HL. Shift right H3. Oh. SI. Although that doesn't work, does it? You can't do it like that. I'm just trying to figure out how this is supposed to work. So, right, so there's logic and arithmetic, and I probably care about logic. I don't really need the arithmetic version. I guess you load in load A with the value of H. And then load H with 3. And then you do that, and then you can do load H with A. And that gets you a shifted version of A. Like that. And then we'd have to do the same thing for L. And that gets us to tile coordinates rather than convert H and L to tile. Like that. And then we can do penalty A. H. There's no multiply, so I would need to do something like this. I basically need to add 32 H times. So add A 32. Well, actually, no, it's loops hurt my head. I need to write down like some basic patterns of how you would write for loops and things. I guess what you'd actually do is inc h by 1, dec h by 1, do the jump. If h is 0, and h loop. Otherwise, you add this, and then jump to check H loop and H loop, like that. You need to do the decrement because you need the arithmetic calculation to check if it's 0. And that's probably the easiest way to do it. So you increment by 1, decrement by 1. It also stops some weirdness when you try and do zeros. And then we do the same thing. Actually, no, we don't have to do the same thing, because then you can just do add a L, I think, because then you just go across. That effectively does the multiplication for you and leaves you with L. So now, now that I've written a whole bunch of stuff I can't easily test, we can try and use it. Right, so let's do this in one direction only, just to be sure. Actually, does this have to be HL? Can I do something else? I'd rather use D and E. Maybe. Might be better. No. And then this is E, 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 and E, and then this is D, and D, and D, and D. Like that. Because now I don't have to shuffle H and L around to keep the RAM in place, which is good. Because what I can do is load the D register here with A and load the E register Oh, I have to do it anyway. What C? Because I might be doing this slightly wrong. Oh, I see, that's a offset thing. Okay. So maybe what I want to do is HRI. Yeah, I can only do that with the load, okay. Inc HL. And then load HL deck HL. So that increases it so I can get the next byte along and then comes back so that I can write the result if it's actually correct. Like that. Right, so this doesn't actually do anything useful. Ugh. I guess that what this actually does is it, like, partially compute, it computes the offset into the VRAM, but it doesn't actually fetch you the value of the VRAM for comparison. I suppose we can do let's assume that we don't care about D&E. And instead put load D whatever the VRAM value is. Not that one. No, screen one, sorry, screen screen zero. Loads E with A. That now has the address in DE. And call destination. Let's push HL. Load HL with D. Can you do that? 16 to 16. The answer is no. No, you can't. You have to do it through A, okay. So then you can do load a HL, please. Finally, index into VRAM and screen tarmap. Okay, so store into A the bitwise OR of the byte point to by HL and A. What? Oh, I guess if you wanted to do it that way instead. Add the signed value of E. Oh crap, okay. There's probably other ways of doing this. Okay. To that just to get the value. Jump. Z, if this is if it's 0, then jump to no down move. No down move. Pop HL. Like that. Okay, so we can't do that. Thought we could. I mean, it is a stupid thing to do, so I'm not surprised that we can't do that, but... It's like, I have these 16 row values, I want to put them somewhere else. LDHD. Like that. I'm actually not expecting any changes right now. I should still be able to move. Oh.
Or not. I don't know what happened. I guess I will come up from the bottom. Eventually. Maybe not. That's strange. I might trash this and start again, because I don't think I did it very well. It may have been a bit ambitious for this time of day. Okay, so we're loading the speed in, we add our bit on top, our new position on top, I suppose. We save that into D. Ah, the A is wrong now. That's a problem. I see the problem. Okay. Load A with C. Okay, so we're moving again. That's a start. So now I just need to change the tile map. HL is the start, BC is the size, okay. Three and some amount. F, E, D, like that. Zero, two, like that.
we get one row of stuff. And I don't move down. I do move up, but then I don't come back, so. But I do come back from the bottom of the screen. Yeah, the down is just totally broken now. Maybe if I move the region down a bit, 32. Zero and four. Do that. Ah, so I can just cross over that boundary without problems. That's stupid. So that indexing is clearly wrong. Well, it could be any number of things in there, actually. Not necessarily just the indexing. This god-awful mess could be very much the problem. I guess it might be easier in this case to store the current coordinates, do the move, check that the position is okay, and then revert, rather than trying to predictively move, which is what I'm doing here. So I might try that, although I don't know if I want to do that right now. Because I would need to hold a lot of stuff simultaneously. This approach seems a little messy. So instead, what we would do is I guess you'd load A with HL. Load prev. I've totally forgotten the name of it already. Yeah, prev chord.
with A, ADC on the speed, that gets us back to where we were. And then you would LD HL with A, that writes it. Then you can do the checking shenanigans, so. E with the H. No. Yeah, so that populates the E correctly. We don't actually have to do that anymore. I don't think. Oh, we do. Yeah, we do. F0. Where in memory is that? Right, so that's all this stuff, so can't really use that to do the fancy plus C offset. Either. That's okay. Yeah, so we put DNA into there. Fetch the value. Reset code. Actually, well, we can pop that now that we don't need it, but. If the down is okay, we don't have to do anything else, so we can just skip. Otherwise, we have to do prev code. HL A like that. To reset. This assumes that the actual coordinate calculation for the tile map is correct, so who knows. My down key doesn't seem to work there, so clearly something that doesn't work.
Okay. So, check destination tile. You put A into the D there, and you shift it by 3. Is that right? No, that would be right, yeah, because you shift it by 3, so you do divide by 2, divide by 4, divide by 8, so. Shift. I don't want to rotate things though, I want to do shifts, please. No, I think I'm using the wrong. Wrong thing. I think I'm going to leave it for now. My brain is a little bit fried and I need to do a lot of research into how this thing works, which is not so interesting to do on stream. So I'm going to check out for this evening, but I think it's been pretty interesting overall. Not quite where we wanted to go, but we got at least the input working. So yeah, thank you everybody for coming to hang out. I will be back hopefully next week. Maybe not Monday, I may not be in the mood for it on Monday, I have a very busy weekend ahead, but definitely next Wednesday. So. Have a good one. See you later. Goodbye.